Welcome to Rally Sunday. Hi, my name is Victoria and I'm part of Senior Girls Rally. It is my pleasure to welcome you here this morning for Rally Sunday. This morning we are going to showcase a little bit of what we have been doing in the various rallies this year. A Scrabble Rally starts in preschool for tiny tots. Then when you are in P3, you enter Junior Rally, and then in secondary school, you enter Senior Rally. The purpose of all our rallies is to give children and young people the opportunity to learn more about Jesus. It's a great place to make friends, play games, and have fun. But ultimately, the goal of every Tuesday and Thursday night is to understand more about who Jesus is and why he wants to know us. We hope you enjoy your time with us this morning. I'm just going to share a few announcements. So we have our annual carol service on the 17th of December, and you're all warmly invited to attend that. At this time, every Sunday, we have our normal family service. If you aren't in the habit of going to church, we would love to have you join us on a Sunday mornings at 11:30. That's the end of my announcements, and now back to the praise band. And after that, the program will run itself. And after we hear from all the rallies, Glenn Johnson will share a short message with us.
Thank you, Victoria. Let's all stand again to sing.
We are born in God's grace through Junior boys' turn now. It's great to see the tiny tots. I remember my kids being that size, no longer. And if you're a parent or a grandparent here, from the smallest wee child up here to a graying old man like me, you'll hear the message that God has for you this morning, and I hope you listen to it and take that in. Our boys are going to perform a wee play. We've been learning about a lot of big characters from the Bible, some of them older than others, right down to children and teenagers. One of them is called Samson. The boys are going to do a play on this. If the narrators want to just come up now, take your posts. This will be the second time they've done this without any direction, so we know they're up to it.
Hey everyone, have you ever not been strong enough to do something?
Maybe you weren't strong enough to hang on the monkey bars.
Or maybe you weren't strong enough to lift the shopping bag into the car.
Well, in today's lesson, we're going to talk about a really strong guy called Samson. And we're going to find out where his strength came from.
God promised to make Samson a warrior. Before he was born, an angel came to his parents and told them their boy would become a great warrior and that he was going to save the Israelites from the Philistines.
All Samson had to do was follow God's rules. The most important rule was he couldn't cut his hair. If his hair was ever cut, he would lose all of his strength. Every time Samson needed the strength, the Spirit of the Lord helped him.
Throughout Samson's life, he did a lot of incredible things that required strength.
Like one time, he had to fight off a lion with nothing but his bare hands.
Another time, he defeated 1,000 Philistines with nothing but the jawbone of a donkey for a weapon.
And all the crazy things he did was because God gave him strength through spirit. But when Samson broke God's rules, he finally lost his strength.
One day, Samson fell in love with a lady named Delilah. The Philistines paid Delilah to find out the secret to Samson's strength.
Eventually, he told her his secret. If he was to cut his hair, he would be breaking his promise to God and lose all of his strength.
So Delilah told the Philistines, and they cut off his hair while he was sleeping, and then they captured him.
He doesn't want to chuck it off me.
But God would make Samson strong again for one last warrior move.
The Philistines tied Samson to a large pillar so they could make fun of him.
So Samson prayed to God so that he would give him strength one last time, and God listened and gave him strength.
Samson broke the pillar and brought the roof down over the Philistines.
So what can we learn from Samson's crazy life? Number one, when we need strength, we can get it from God. Number two, Samson was only strong because God was with him, and we can have that same strength.
Don't want to be biased, but Junior Boys just is the best. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength.
think that's worth another round of applause. That's class. Thank you. Usually they're not acting, they're usually acting up. But I have some enrollment certificates here. Is Parker or Kaya here anywhere? Maybe they're not sitting with us. No. Well, then we have one for Noah Curran. All right.
Thank you. brilliant, girls. Absolutely brilliant. As you can tell, we're having a great time every Tuesday night. I never thought that I'd be wearing a tutu at my age, David. But with Zumba the other night, I never thought either that June McCartney will be doing Zumba all night. David? So we have lots of new girls this year in Raleigh. We start with the P3s. Neva Hamilton, is she here today? You come and get it. And you can go and have a wee thing. Isabella. Is Nina here? Is Nina here? No. Lily. Sophia. Charlotte. Charlotte not here. Kira in her P4s. Well done, Kira. Addison. Addison Kelly not here. Aaliyah. Aaliyah not here today. Faith Brotherstone. Well done. Jessica in P6. No, Jessica, no. And Ocean in P7. Is Ocean not here? And Jessica and Patton. Thank you so much, girl.
Okay, we're going to move on now to senior girls. I think teenage girls get a reputation for being quite terrifying. But actually, we have the most fantastic bunch of girls. And we just, as leaders, look forward to Tuesday night every week, genuinely. And I remember someone saying to me in March last year, I'm sure you're delighted to be finished senior girls for the year. And we as leaders all agreed that actually we weren't. Because we were going to really, really miss the girls. We do have a great time with them on a Tuesday night. So you see them all over here, the sea of blue over in the corner. That's the senior girls. I'm not going to ask them all to join us. But this year, we have been studying women of the Bible. So one week in Raleigh, we have a speaker come along to speak for 15 or 20 minutes. And then the following week, we get into groups and do a study on the same topic. And I have been in some of the study groups with the girls, and some of the points they make are absolutely fantastic. I have learnt so much from them. So rather than me telling you what we've been studying, I'm going to invite some of the girls to come up and share what they have learnt this year with us. So can I ask Eliza, Melanie, Kerry, and Emma to come up and join me? Okay, so Eliza, hello, nice to see you. This year, which woman stood out to you that we've been studying, and can you tell us just a very brief little bit about her?
The woman that stood out to me was the Samaritan woman. She was an outcast because she'd been married several times, and in this story, she was going to the well, but she was going on her own because she was embarrassed of her sin, and she met Jesus there.
Okay, great. And was there anything that surprised you in the story?
The thing that surprised me was the fact that she was always trying to run away and hide from her sin, but then Jesus actively sought her out and told her that he was the true Christ.
That's great, thank you. And did you learn anything from that? So it's all very well to read these stories, but did you learn anything from that that you could apply to your life or that meant something to you?
I learned that if we keep trying to please ourselves in this life, we will never be truly pleased unless we're walking with him in Christ.
Brilliant. Thank you, Eliza. Thank you, Eliza. Okay, Melanie, we just chatted about this on Tuesday night past, and I was so encouraged by what you shared. Who was the lady in Luke 21 that really struck you? Tell us what happens in those few short verses.
So in Luke chapter 21, verses verses 1 to 4. It's the widow at the temple treasury. She walks in and she sees all these rich people putting in big amounts of money because they're all rich and they can afford to do so. She just puts in like a small amount of money. She just puts in two small copper coins, and Jesus notices and he says to his disciples, "This woman has given more than anyone else in this temple, for they out of their abundance have given what they could, but she just gave all she had."
I think maybe we should get Melanie to speak on a Tuesday night. That was a great summary. Okay, so what stood out to you about the widow?
What stood out to me about her is that she didn't try and show off about her generosity. She was giving all she had, but she didn't try and make a big deal out of it, and she wasn't looking for attention. And again, she gave literally all she had. So she gave to the temple and therefore to Jesus everything that she possibly could.
And was there anything that you sort of wanted to apply for to your own life out of that?
Yeah, that you should always be giving what you can to Jesus, not trying to show off about it, not trying to make a big deal out of it, but you always should try and give what you can and do what you can for Jesus.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Melanie. That's great. And then, Kerry, which woman stood out to you?
So Deborah stood out to me.
And you want to tell us who she was?
So Deborah was a prophetess and a judge. So, yeah.
Okay, and why did you find the story of Deborah interesting? Why her?
I found it really interesting because she really stayed faithful to God, even when maybe not everyone would have respected her because she was a female and she was giving orders to men and stuff.
Okay, great. And did you learn anything relevant to your life in 2023 from this woman who lived so long ago?
I think I really learned that God can use anyone, like no matter how weak or strong, because like not necessarily everyone would have expected a woman to be able to do that, and she did.
Fantastic. Thank you, Kerry. And finally, Emma. So which woman did you enjoy, and can you tell us a wee bit about her story?
So I enjoyed learning about Lydia. Lydia was a dealer in purple, and she was from Thyatira, and she was a worshipper of the Lord.
Okay, and what struck you most about her? Why did you like her?
What struck me was the fact that she only had to hear Paul's message once for her heart to be opened, and her whole family got baptized because of it.
Brilliant, brilliant. And anything you could apply to your life out of that?
She was a really welcoming person, and she welcomed believers into her house. So that tells us that we should do the same, and not just for believers.
Fantastic. Give them all a round of applause. Thank you, girls. Great. We really do have such great conversations with the girls, but we also have a really good laugh with them. We've done all kinds of activities, from Zumba to making masks to all kinds of sport and activities. Senior Girls is very chilled. There's a lot of laughing and a lot of chatting and all of that kind of thing. So just to finish off, Senior Girls for now, that my co-leader Claire has put together a video just giving you a little bit of an insight into what happens on a Tuesday night. And thank you to those of you who are here for sending your girls. We just love spending the time with them, but I hope you enjoy this little insight into Senior Girls.
girls is amazing.
We love Zumba night.
I really enjoyed it because we got to dress up like we were in the 80s.
I love the Zumba night and I like the people.
My favourite thing about EGR was the waterside at camp and Ellie's Mona Lisa t-shirt.
Really, really great.
Study groups. Rally camp.
Me giving Lana a Dorito, her choking on it and falling off the seat.
Zumba.
I like coming to Senior Girls because of learning about God and all my friends.
I like the sports at Senior EGR.
I love the topic that we're learning about in Senior Girls this year.
That was great, wasn't it? I'm here to talk about senior boys and obviously involve the boys here. We've had a brilliant year in senior boys so far, and this photo is just some of the boys and leaders that have been coming along, and this morning you're going to get to hear from 10 of them. If you flick the next slide. We had a great night there just on Thursday past, and never in all my years in EBR thought the boys would be making their own burgers and cooking, and thanks to Albert for that and our master chef McAvoy, who was, and I haven't heard of food poisoning yet, so I think we're all okay. But as leaders, you know, we've loved getting to know the boys this year, but also we want to learn more about God and his son, Jesus. And unique to the Gospel of John, there are seven statements and Jesus begins saying, I am, and that's what we're going to look at today. If you flick the next slide there. The phrase I am reflects Exodus 3:14, where God introduces himself to Moses with this expression, I am who I am. And this statement became a way to connect with God personally and was used throughout Israel's history to convey that God always was, always is, and always will be. In using this expression, Jesus is explicitly identifying himself as God and bearing God's presence on earth. Some of the boys now are going to read the verses from the Gospel of John, and then three of our oldest boys will take it in turn to explain the I ams and what they actually mean to them. Steve, could you get the boys up here now? And what we'll do is the first seven boys are just going to read the I am statements. So boys, read them nice and slow so that everyone can really get to hear them. And then straight after that, Nathan Wiggle's going to come up and explain about the light of the world. Zach Hagen is going to explain about the bread of life, and Calvin's going to explain about the door and the good shepherd. Thanks.
Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty.
John chapter 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
John 10, verse 9, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and will go in and out and find pasture.
I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. John chapter 10, verse 11.
John 11, verse 25 says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
John chapter 15, verses 1 and 5. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
So this year at Senior EBR, we have been looking at the I ams of Jesus and what each of them means. The one that I have been assigned to talk about today is Jesus being the light of the world. At the start of John 8, an adulteress is brought before Jesus, and he responds to the crowd by saying that anyone who is without sin should cast the first stone. Each of them leaves one by one, and after this, Jesus says to the woman that he does not condemn her. And it is after this that Jesus says to the people around him and the Pharisees in John 8, verse 12, he says, and again Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So the first thing that we can learn from Jesus being the light of the world is that without Jesus, life is meaningless. Light is essential to life. Without it, plants will be unable to grow, animals wouldn't be able to survive, and we wouldn't be able to see anything. We just would not be able to live. It's the same here. If we do not have Jesus as the light in our lives, we are unable to live a life which is honoring and pleasing unto God. Our life would be completely meaningless. And the second aspect is that light dispels and reveals darkness. When you walk into a room, you would turn on the light. If you do not, you would stumble and fall over any of the unseen objects lying within the room. The darkness in our lives is sin. In Proverbs 4, verse 19, it says, "The way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble." Jesus, like light, reveals our sins to us through the help of His Holy Spirit working in our lives, and He takes away our sins just as light dispels darkness. As the light of the world, Jesus died on the cross and paid the price for the sins which we deserve to die for, so that we could be reconciled to God.
In John 6, Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." This may seem like a strange title, but to those who Jesus was speaking to, they would have understood his point. At the start of the chapter, we see Jesus performing the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. We see how Jesus provided for the people's hunger as he took 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish and multiplied them out, feeding the whole crowd with 12 baskets left over. The next day, after Jesus and the disciples had crossed the lake, people went across and found him near Capernaum. They wanted a Messiah to free them from the Roman rule and to meet their physical needs, but they lacked any awareness of the deeper spiritual needs of the heart. He encourages them to seek eternal life, which only he can bring. The people, sometimes like us, were more interested in Jesus fulfilling their physical needs that they completely overlooked their spiritual needs. Jesus tells them, "This is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one he has sent. If we repent of our sins and put our trust in Jesus, he promises to give us eternal life." The crowd then demand a sign to prove that Jesus was in fact the Son of God. They reference how God had provided the Israelites with manna from the heaven in the wilderness. Jesus responds by telling them that they need to ask for the true bread from heaven. And when they ask him this, Jesus startles them by saying, "I'm the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." Jesus is making it clear that they shouldn't be focusing on physical food that perishes, but more important is their spiritual need, which can only be satisfied by Jesus himself. He's applying that he's essential for everyone, because it's only through Jesus that our relationship with God can be restored. Without Jesus in our lives, we have no hope or purpose on this earth, and we solely rely on him to guide us through life. Bread and food are essential for life on earth, but Jesus as our Savior is essential for eternal life.
Right, so very quickly before I start, I realise after preparing this thought that we're not all shepherds in late BC and early AD, so you might not understand this before I read it. So if you imagine, this is what it's talking about. A sheepfold would have simply been 3 walls like that, and then they wouldn't have actually had a physical gate. So the shepherd would have laid down in front of it and actually been that gate. So that's why, or the door, as it says in here, that's why in some translations of the Bible, it actually says, "I am the door," and not, or no, "I am the gate," and not, "I am the door." So when Jesus claims to be the door, he's telling us that he's the only way that we as sheep can make it into that sheepfold, which is heaven, and the only way that we can get there is through our Lord Jesus. It is in Christ that we can find our peace, true peace, which brings me to Psalm 23, where the Lord is described as our shepherd, and how he makes us lie down in green pastures. Which is Jesus referring to when he says about us finding pasture in him, because we can find rest in Jesus. Jesus is our refuge, and he is the only way to true peace and fulfillment. Life to the full is in Jesus, and don't let the world tell you otherwise. The thief, which is referring to the devil, will come to seek and destroy our lives and the people around us, but Jesus is saying that he will protect us from that. The devil searches to seek and destroy our lives by tempting us with things of this world that promise some sort of fulfillment. But there is only pain and suffering and emptiness that follows when you buy into the lies of the devil. But Jesus says that he has come that we may have life and have it to the full. And it's more powerful than the devil could ever be. Jesus then makes a second claim. I am the good shepherd. And he says that the good shepherd lays his life down for his sheep. And we know that this is true. As we hear in the story of David about him having to fight off lions and bears in order to protect his sheep. Now Jesus, a descendant of David, is now saying that he will lay his life down for the sheep. So I love that sort of correlation. Jesus then talks about a hired hand who does not care about the sheep because he doesn't own the sheep. So then when the wolf comes, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The hired hand is clearly a representation of worldly things that we put above God in our lives. I don't know what that is for you. It could be money. It could be your family, which are all great things. But things happen which we don't expect. You know, we lose money or a family member passes away unexpectedly. But God will never leave us or forsake us. Christ Jesus will never leave us or forsake us. And he bore our burden on the cross. That's why he's the good shepherd, because he laid down his life in our place. He took the punishment that we rightfully deserved. And he is the door, because he is the only way that we can enter into the kingdom of heaven and be saved from our sins, which we clearly deserve our punishment for. But the Lord Jesus Christ laid down his life for you and for me, so we don't have to have this punishment, but you can ever have everlasting life and have it to the full.
Great. Good morning. Thank you very much. I'm going to just bring a brief message, but before I do that, I just want to say a couple of things. First of all, I want to thank you as parents and grannies and grandas and people who look after these wee children. We are very grateful that you trust them into our care every week, that you send them along here. So thank you for doing that. It is a genuine pleasure to have them, well, most of the time, to have them here and to be able to look after them. And we also appreciate that as a duty of care that you place on us, and we don't take that lightly. So thank you. Let me thank all the boys and girls. By the way, Tiny Tots, you were on very early, and you have been amazing since then. You've sat so well. You've been brilliant. So thank you for that. Thank you for all the boys and girls who have done something for us this morning. So let me invite all of you to give all of them just a wee round of applause as well for performing for us. And finally, I think it would be remiss not to thank the leaders. We are very grateful to people who give up time. And the likes of the Tiny Tots and Junior Rallies are quite early. So a lot of them are rushing from work and coming down here, getting a wee quick tea or whatever, and then coming down to spend time with your children. And we're very, very grateful for that as well. So I think it would be appropriate for you as parents and grannies and grandads and what have you to give all the leaders a round of applause just to show your appreciation for what they do. Brilliant. So a couple of weeks ago, Model Primary School in Regent House Prep, we had a thing in church here called a prayer space. And I was trying to teach children just what prayer was through different wee aspects. Who came to that? Who was along at that? Yeah, some of the girls from junior girls and some of the boys from junior boys as well. And it was all different activities. So this one that's on the screen was Dream Clouds. And the idea was getting the children to think about what they might like to do for their future. So these are some of the things that they said. So you might just need to do that, Dave, just click it off and on again. Different wee things that they wanted to do in the future. So someone said, I want to be a teacher. I also want to be happy. That's quite nice. I'm not sure that goes hand in hand, to be fair, but anyway. Okay, next one. I want to be a YouTuber. And then they came back and changed it. I want to be a famous YouTuber. Next one. I want to get the level 400 in Fortnite. Now, I have no clue. Is that good? Is level 400 good? Yeah? Well, it depends. Okay, next one. I want to be a hairdresser. There you go. Next one, Dave. Keep them coming there. Spaceman. May well be that this person is already a space cadet and just in training, but anyway. Next one. A mother and a P1 teacher. Isn't that sweet? That's lovely. Next one. Now, this is good. And my suggestion is, you're in church, none of that, carry on, okay? You can't cheer. So my suggestion is this person is going to go places, probably the championship. So I want to play for Man United. If that is you, just keep, honestly, we're about to enter into a new phase. Things are going to be good, and it's all going to be fine. We'll get, anyway, so next one. I want to be a hairdresser and a professional trampoliner, and I want to make a skincare brand for all types of skin. So there we go. I personally do well. I'm hoping they're not going to do the hairdressing and the trampolining at the same time, because that might not turn out too well. So just different ideas. Just the next slide, Dave, of things that people want to do. Does any of you know what you might like to do when you grow up? Anybody, any ideas? There's some. Shout it out nice and loud. A what chef? A dessert chef. Very specific. There you are. A dessert chef. Anybody else know what you might? Oh, there's two girls over there. What are you? Against the wall, what would you like to do when you grow up, do you think? A vet. That's lovely, looking after animals. What would you like to do? A vet as well. Poppy, what do you want to do? A hairdresser. What would you? An author, an illustrator. My goodness, what would you? An artist. Well, listen. There you go. You two could get together, author, illustrator. If you're good at the writing bit, not so good at the drawing, so he wants to be an artist, you could form a wee partnership. That would be good. What would you like to be when you grow up? An artist as well. Evie? A pilot. Good on you. That is very good. That's last two. A policeman. What about you? A builder. Very good. Isn't it great to have? Oh, I'm going to ask these last two boys. Go for it. What would you like to be, Noah? A policeman as well. And what about you, last one? A thinker. You'd be good at that. Now, so if you had asked me, whenever I was their age, if you had asked me, I would have said policeman. And actually, that's all I ever wanted to do. So I grew up in the Scrabble Estate just across the road here. And what I used to do, so 1970s, that's about 8 or 9 or whatever, late 1970s. And I used to get pieces of paper, and I would get the paper, I would fold it up, and I would draw a wee face on the front of it, and I would write driving license, and I would give it to all my friends on their BMXs. And then I would go and hide somewhere, and they'd be flying around their BMXs. I would jump out and go, whoa, slow down, slow down. You're going, there's children playing in this estate here. You're going too fast. Have you got your license? And they would give me back the wee license that I'd made for them. And I would give them a warning and send them on their way. So I should have found them, actually. I wasn't thinking. But that's all I ever wanted to do. And then whenever I left school, whenever I grew up, I joined the police. And after a wee while, I thought, I'm not so sure I want to be a policeman anymore. And something happened to me when I was 9, and it completely changed the whole course of my life. Because when I was 9, see me to some of you, I became a Christian. So I was along a Sunday school one week, and I just listened to what the boys and girls have been hearing at rally, understood that Jesus had died for me, understood that he had a plan for my life, asked him into my heart to be my savior. Fast forward 10 years to when I was in the police, that decision as a child had a big impact on my life as an adult. And what we were doing with those dream clouds when the boys and girls were here and saying to him, thinking about the future, we're saying, you know what? It's important to realize that God has a plan for your future as well. I mean, not just what you want to do, but God has a plan. And I was explaining that I prayed and said to God, if you have something else you want me to do, apart from being in the police, would you show that to me? And he did. And I've been doing that now for all those years since then. So I've been in this church doing that same thing, and they just haven't been able to get rid of me. But that's just the way it goes. But you know what? I'm absolutely 100% convinced that God had a plan, has a plan, showed me that plan for my life. And I believe it's the same for all of them as well. Just put that next week's slide up, Dave, if you would. Sorry, just after that. So let me read you some verses from Psalm 139. I love this psalm. It's a beautiful psalm. David, and reflecting on how God thinks about him. So here's some verses from it. Lord, you know me. You've searched me. You know when I sit down, when I rise, you perceive my thoughts from afar. You see me going out and my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. And then verses 13 and 14 say this. You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. And we get that from these children and young people. That is a God who made them, who loves them, who cares deeply for them, who put them together, has a plan and purpose for their life. And the last verse from this psalm that I was thinking about is verse 16. This is what it says. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. I'm convinced of the truth of that, that God has a plan and a purpose for our lives, even before we're born. And that is the level of care and interest he has in these children, from the youngest to the oldest teenager and all of you. He's a plan and purpose for our lives. I'm convinced of that. I've absolutely no doubt about that. And I think it starts when we come to know him. And what we've seen this morning, the program that the boys and girls put together for us, the Tiny Tots started off with the rally motto, "Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth." And we think it's so, so important that children are taught this from the youngest age, to know that there's a God who loves them, cares for them, a Savior who died for them, and to remember in the sense of knowing him as their Father and Savior and Lord. And the junior boys taught us the story of Samson, a man chosen by God who wasn't perfect, by the way, made mistakes, had flaws, wasted a lot of his life when he should have been living it for God, but ultimately used what God had given for his purposes and for his glory. And the senior girls, Lydia, Deborah, a Samaritan woman, a widow, all women who responded to God, and God showed them the plan he had through their lives because they obeyed him and lived for him. And then the senior boys, all these great declarations of who Jesus was, and the three that were explained, Jesus, the bread of life, the light of the world, and the door, and the shepherd. And we're convinced of this, that there's a God in heaven who loves us, knows us, cares about us, has a plan and purpose for our lives, wants us to respond to these truths and to live for him and follow him. Finally, last wee slide, Dave. This is a postcard, picture of a postcard that came through our door several years ago, along with a whole other bump email or junk mail. Most of it we've been, but I was sort of struck by this. It says, "The greatest legacy we can leave our children is happy memories." I hope that our kids have happy memories. I do not agree with that postcard. I hope that my kids, who are now not kids, have happy memories of growing up. But it's so much more important than having happy memories. I think actually the greatest legacy we can leave our children is faith. Faith in God, a personal relationship with Jesus. And that is the heart of all of the leaders who every week come along here and open the Bible and share with your children and young people. And we don't sneak it in somewhere after we've done Zumba or bacon or football. It's actually the primary focus of the rally movement here in Scrabble, showing the reality of God and his love. And as the junior girls sang beautifully, to know Jesus as friend, to know Jesus as being faithful, to know Jesus as the true King, the Lord of creation, to know him as the ruler without end, to know the hope of Jesus, to know the peace of Jesus, and ultimately to know Jesus as wonderful Savior. That is our prayer for your children, for your young people, and for you as well. And we pray consistently that they would discover that and realize that and know that. And we also pray that you would know that and understand that as well. We are really deeply grateful for you being here this morning and also for allowing your children to come here. But I hope you realize and understand that it is so, so important to know this truth personally and then to live it out personally in the lives of your children and young people. I'm going to pray and then our morning is over. I'm not too sure what's happening. Are the children going back to where, or are they just being collected from where they are, or what do you think? Nobody knows. I'm going to pray and then leave it up to them. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for everything that we have enjoyed this morning. Thank you for all of the children, for everything that they have brought to us, these great truths through readings and drama and song and interview. And thank you for the reality of a God who loves us and has a plan and a purpose for our lives. And I pray that they would understand that and they would see that. And the most important thing in their life would be what you want for them, their future in your hands. And I pray that would be the same for all of us. Thank you for this morning we've enjoyed together this morning. Thank you for everyone that's here. And I pray you'll bless us now as we go and continue just to challenge us to know you as Father and your Son as Lord and Savior. We pray this giving you thanks in his precious name and for his glory. Amen. Thanks for coming. God bless you.